serving Jesus. Unfortunately, sometimes there's nerves too, so I apologize. My voice is a little shaky. As Jerry said, I'm Kevin Devine, for those of you who don't know me. And I have the privilege of serving as a deacon here at First Baptist of Avoca. For that reason, I have the opportunity to share God's Word with you tonight. As I reflected on what I wanted to speak tonight about, several things came to my mind. Several of the needs of the church that I think could have been addressed, especially new beginnings with people coming and going, and opportunities that those changes present. I also thought of just sharing my testimony. I've always enjoyed the opportunity to speak about how God's grace has personally impacted my life. And I considered sharing from Ephesians 6, consider that my life verse, the armor of God. And I think that's always worth a refresher. What God ultimately laid on my heart over the past 10 days or so is a response to a very common question that I've been hearing a lot lately. And that's, why does God allow for suffering and evil? And that's really a loaded question. I'm sure it's going to take far more time than we have allotted here tonight. But thankfully, Bill didn't really give me any guidelines. And Mark just said, well, take as much time as you need and I'll fill in the rest. So I guess I don't have a time limit. And hopefully none of you are looking forward to Sunday Night Football. I joke, but you know, I have heard that question a number of times in the news, on Facebook, and from people around me at work. And while the issue of evil and suffering is certainly nothing new, it has been brought to the forefront recently. You know, the storms that have ravaged Texas and the Southeast, and it's pertinent with several of the situations within our congregation as well: health issues, marital problems, strife among church members. These all cause suffering in some type, and they affect all of us to some degree. And then Friday morning with yet another terrorist attack in Europe, I felt a burden that this was really what God wanted me to share tonight, as the issue of suffering and evil is again brought to mind. And I think that the question of why God would allow suffering and evil presents one of the hardest questions to Christians, especially when addressing the unsaved. I think back to when I lived in Vermont following Hurricane Irene and the destruction around us, and I had a coworker who told me that she couldn't believe in a God who would allow this type of destruction and suffering. And I wish that I had been as prepared at that point to answer her and to provide a response as I am today. Because if you can't believe in a God that would allow for suffering and allow evil, you can't believe in the true God of the Bible. And so that's what we're going to explore this evening. If you have your Bibles and want to follow along, I'll be starting in Lamentations chapter 3. Lamentations chapter 3, starting in verse 1. I am the man who has seen affliction by the rod of his wrath. He has led me and made me walk in darkness and not in light. Surely he has turned his hand against me. Time and time again throughout the day, he has aged my flesh and my skin and broken my bones. He has besieged me and surrounded me with bitterness and woe. He has set me in dark places like the dead of long ago. He has hedged me in so that I cannot get out and has made my chain heavy. Even when I cry and shout, he shuts out my prayer. He has blocked my ways with hewn stone. He has made my paths crooked. He has been to me a bear lying in wait like a lion in ambush. He has turned aside my ways and torn me in pieces. He has made me desolate. He has bent his bow and set me up as a target for the arrow. He has caused the arrows of his quiver to pierce my loins. I have become the ridicule of all my people, their taunting song all the day. He has filled me with bitterness. He has made me drink wormwood. He has also broken my teeth with gravel and covered me with ashes. He moved my soul far from peace. I have forgotten prosperity. And I said, my strength and my hope have perished from the Lord. Remember my affliction and roaming, the wormwood and the gall. My soul still remembers and sinks within me. This I recall to mind, therefore I have hope. Through the Lord's mercies we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I hope in him. So the writer of Lamentations widely believed to be the prophet Jeremiah, is writing this right about the time of the fall of Jerusalem. He's obviously been through a lot of pain, a lot of suffering. He's seen war as the Babylonian army has progressively taken over the walls of Jerusalem and surrounded them. And as King Nebuchadnezzar kind of isolated the people in Jerusalem, food ran out, starvation and disease overtook the city quickly. And the writer saw firsthand evil and suffering. And I think right from the beginning tonight, it would do us a lot of good to mark a distinction between what suffering is and what evil is. Because the writer throughout Lamentations clearly attributed his suffering to God. Suffering is pain without the understanding where that pain is coming from or why that pain is occurring. And it's clear throughout the passage and other portions of Scripture that God can both cause suffering and allow suffering with the intention of using it to bring about his purposes. God, on the other hand, is completely incapable of evil. As James put it in chapter 1, verses 13 through 15, let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then, when desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. James makes it clear here that God is not the originator of evil, and rather it's man's sinful desires that cause evil to take root and give birth to sin. You know, the Christian thinker Augustine describes evil as not a thing in and of itself, but rather a parasite on good and something that is lacking. I think if we think about what a parasite actually does, as it sucks the life out of a host organism and attacks unprotected organisms in whatever it's attacking, it does irreparable harm to that organism. And if you think about that, and you think about what evil does, as it sucks the life out of unprotected areas in our lives, and doing irreparable harm to us, it makes sense. It solves the problem of evil for a lot of Christians. So it's because evil is not an actual thing, God cannot be the author or creator of it. So it makes sense that evil is not a created thing. It's not created by God, but rather it's the absence of God. It's an area where God is not present in our lives, and that allows attacks which can attack our humanity. The Bible supports this description in many ways. It shows that we are incomplete without God, and therefore that incompleteness allows us to be open to attacks from evil. We see this clearly in Scripture in Colossians 2, 9 and 10. For in him dwells the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, who is the head of all principality and power. One day we're going to become complete when we're united with Jesus in heaven. Okay? However, as long as we live here on this earth, we are going to continue to be incomplete. And therefore, we have areas of our lives that aren't given over completely to God, that aren't submitted completely to him, where God is not present and foremost and central in our lives. And these are areas where evil will, therefore, be allowed to penetrate. And the parasite of evil, the absence of God, will continue to infiltrate. Many people say that evil is actually proof that God does not exist or that God is not all-powerful. However, thinking of evil this way as a parasite, as the lack of God, as a space where God is not present, actually uses evil as a proof for God. In order to call something evil, we have to have a basis of what good is. We have to have a standard of what right and wrong is. While the world doesn't have that standard, and it becomes more and more relative by the day, Christians have that standard, and that's the Bible, it's the Word of God. Without God, there is no basis for calling something evil. God cannot be the creator of evil, nor be held accountable for evil and suffering. We cannot, however, ignore that God does allow evil. And as such, we're going to take a look at two types of evil that God has chosen to allow in this world. Moral evil and natural evil. Moral evil isn't hard to understand. It's something morally or ethically wrong with human nature. When people lie, cheat, steal, when there's violence, when there's attacks, it just goes to show that there is something fundamentally wrong with human nature. Christians have a very clear answer to what that is. It can be directly attributed to sin. Lucifer wanted to be like God. He didn't think that worshiping and serving God, the God who created him, was enough. He allowed his pride to create a vacuum within him where God was not present, and that caused him to think that he should be elevated and worshiped like God. So he sinned. He was banished to earth, where he deceived Adam and Eve. He led them to think that, you know what, maybe what God had told them wasn't true. Maybe there was an area in their lives where they didn't need God. Maybe they didn't need to listen to God because that fruit looked good. It was good for food, and it was good for knowledge. So they sinned, and they tried to hide it from God. And that separated themselves and left a vacuum, a space, where God was not present in their lives. Both of them sinned and tried to hide from God. They separated themselves from the Creator. And the separation from God separated them from what God had planned for them. With Lucifer, he had planned for him to guard the garden, his most precious possession. He was the most beautiful angel that he'd ever created. With Adam and Eve, they were to work the ground. They were to care for God's creation. And when they chose to rebel against God, it created a vacuum and allowed sin to enter. This is exactly the description that Augustine gave. The absence of God allowed the parasite of sin to fester. Moral evil certainly supports the biblical description of man. If you turn to Ecclesiastes 7:20, for there is not a just man on earth who does good and does not sin. In fact, the Bible doesn't shy away from explaining many different types of moral evil. Rather, it confronts them head on. In Mark, we read in chapter 7, verses 21 to 23, for from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lewdness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All of these things come from within and defile a man. Most of the instances of moral evil in the world can be attributed directly to things that Mark just wrote about in one paragraph, and therefore directly attributed to man's sinful heart. Natural disasters and suffering due to health and then that type of thing, however, present a much more difficult problem. And I think this is where a lot of Christians struggle. These are what are referred to as natural evil. However, the Bible doesn't shy away from these types of evil and the suffering that they cause either. It's very clear that paradise has been lost. When Adam and Eve sinned in the garden and broke communion with God, that caused us to live in a fallen world. And it's not just the people that their sin affected. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 8, verse 22, for we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pains together until now. Luke then addresses natural disasters more specifically, quoting Jesus in Luke 21, verse 11. And there will be great earthquakes in various places, and famines and pestilence, and there will be fearful sights and great signs from heaven. And then later in verses 25 and 26, it says, there will be signs in the sun, in the moon, in the stars, and on earth, distress of the nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's heart failing them from fear at the expectation of those things which are coming from the earth. The sea and the waves roaring, men's heart failing. That sounds a lot like a hurricane to me. The Bible repeatedly tells us about different types of natural disasters that will befall mankind and earth before the end times come. No one can know exactly when Jesus is coming back, but we do know that the time is getting closer. Therefore, we should not be surprised by looking at the events that are happening around us and seeing them happen with more and more frequency. We should be, however, in response, lifting our eyes to God, lifting our eyes to heaven as our redemption draws near. So we've established that there's two types of evil, moral evil and natural evil. And that God has allowed them on this earth, but it still doesn't answer the question that I started with. Why does God allow it? There are several possible reasons why God chooses to allow suffering, and they're evident throughout the Bible. The first one that came to mind when I was preparing was Paul and refinement. So, personal refinement. God allowed Paul to suffer to develop in him characteristics that would allow him to serve multiple different churches and reach multiple different types of people during his ministry and accomplish the work that God had set out for him. The next thing that I thought of was Job, and it allowed Job to prove his faith in God. God actually challenged Satan in Job 1:8. It says, then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? God actually used evil and suffering that befell Job to discredit Satan. Think about that. God took one of his most faithful servants and allowed suffering to him in order to combat evil. He took what Satan meant for bad and used it to discredit Satan. This provided not only a huge blow to Satan, but an example for us and for all of those that read the book of Job to follow. God then allowed lepers to suffer. He allowed blind men to suffer. He allowed the Samaritan woman at the well to suffer great things. Why? To prove his ability to redeem. If it weren't for these stories and more, we would not have as great an understanding as we do about the extent of our God's love. So while we clearly see examples of how God used evil and suffering for refinement, for proving of faith, to discredit Satan, to combat evil, and to prove his ability to redeem, one more thought came to mind. And that's that God allowed Jesus to suffer all things. Hunger, pain, loss, violence, slander. The list goes on and on. God allowed Jesus to suffer all things in order that he could become the payment for our sin. How conceited would we have to be to think that God would allow his only son to suffer everything and then not allow us to suffer even a little bit while we're here on earth. Maybe God could have created a world without suffering, without evil. But that would have prevented and restricted us from understanding the true extent of our God's love. Romans 8:18, Paul writes, "For I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Paul shows us here that all suffering needs to be compared to the glory that we're going to receive one day. If you've accepted Christ as your Savior, you have the benefit of knowing that this life is not all that there is, and that we can look forward to a life described in Revelation 21, where God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. I've heard people ask, if God has the power to overcome evil and do away with suffering, why hasn't he done it yet? And the answer to that is, we just don't understand time, especially God's time, nor do we understand God's will or his intentions. We do know, however, that he has promised to do away with suffering. Once and for all, he is faithful to fulfill his promises, and just as we can rest assured that Christ will come back as he promised, we can know that God will do away with suffering for those who trust in him. Why does God delay? Because he's merciful. He's waiting for all of his elect to have the opportunity to accept his offer of salvation. 2 Peter 3:9 puts it this way, "The Lord is not slack considering his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." God does not delay because he wants us to suffer more, yet because he wants to allow those who have not yet accepted his offer of salvation to accept that offer and be able to avoid eternal suffering. He's waiting, he's delaying, because he's patient. God tells us that it has to get worse before it gets better. In Mark 13, we read, "When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be troubled, for such things must happen, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be earthquakes in various places, and there will be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrow." Jesus here is not commanding us to rejoice in suffering or disaster. He's not commanding us to be happy about destruction. He does, however, give us a reason to cling to the hope that even when confronted with evil. We have hope in Jesus Christ, and we can look forward to the day when such sorrows will cease. While God did not create evil, suffering, and pain, he certainly is powerful enough to use them to bring people closer to him. So we should expect to see evil and suffering while on earth, and we need to be ready and know how to react. So how do we react to evil and suffering? We have to act humbly, we have to act faithfully in love. We can see three specific ways that we should react to suffering in Job chapter 2. Job chapter 2, verses 11 through 13 say, "Now when Job's three friends heard of all this adversity that had come upon him, each one came from his own place. Eliphaz, the Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamathite. And they had made an appointment together to come and mourn with him and comfort him. And when they raised their eyes from afar, they did not recognize him. They lifted their voices and wept, and each one tore his robe and sprinkled dust on his head and looked toward heaven. So they sat down with him on the ground 7 days and 7 nights, and no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that his grief was very great." So first of all, Job's friends were there. When we see others who are suffering, we need to be there. We can't hide in our homes and think, "Oh, it didn't affect me." We can't hide from the fact that suffering does exist in this world. We need to confront it. And we need to be there for people who are suffering. If we're hiding and we're not confronting evil and sin, we're not doing what we need to do to further the cause of Christ. When we have loved ones, friends, family who are suffering, we need to be there for them. Second, we need to be empathetic and understanding. Job's friends wept with him. They mourned with him. They tore their robes and they looked to heaven. We need to mourn with those who are suffering. We need to pray for them, just as Job's friends did. They may not be able to see clearly through their circumstances that they're in. They may be too overwhelmed with their own suffering to realize that there even is a need for prayer. So we need to look to heaven for them, just like Job's friends did in verse 12. And third, we need to recognize their needs and meet them there. Maybe like Job, they just need someone there to sit with them silently for a week. Maybe they need someone to talk to and confide in. We need to be able to realistically look at the grief and figure out what they need. However, we need to not proclaim God's judgment, because we cannot possibly know the reason that God has allowed the suffering to those people. Job's friends, after responding appropriately, then proceeded to spend the next 21 chapters inaccurately representing why they thought God was judging Job and had allowed Job to suffer. And they paid the price for it. Job 42, verse 7, read, "And so it was, after the Lord had spoken these words to Job, that the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, 'My wrath is aroused against you and your two friends, for you have not spoken to me what is right, as my servant has.'" When we misrepresent God's word to others, we incur God's wrath. We need to be very careful how we respond to others in the time of affliction. As we comfort, as we mourn, as we rebuild, as we come alongside, as we carefully consider the situation and avoid speaking for God, we must orient ourselves to the glory and hope found in Jesus Christ and the promise of restoration of God's goodness. Our response to evil and suffering has to take us back to Jeremiah's response in Lamentations 3. "My soul still remembers and sinks within me. This I recall to my mind, therefore I hope. Through the Lord's mercies we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." All right, we're going to close in a word of prayer, and then I think I'll give Mark a few minutes, and we can get over football, all right? Heavenly Father, I thank you for this evening. I thank you especially for your word, how it speaks to us in our need. We thank you that you've given us something that is true and good, and that we have the hope found only in your Son, Jesus Christ. We praise you, Lord, for the abundant blessings that you shower upon us. And I pray that as we encounter evil and suffering of all types in this world, that you use it to orient us towards you, and use us to be salt and light into the world, to show others how merciful and how loving you are. I pray for the unspoken needs of the church, for those in the church that are suffering tonight, and I pray that you be a comfort to them, and help your word to reach them in their needs. In Jesus' holy and precious name, I pray.